Okay, ladies and gentlemen, as I'm a stickler for timekeeping and efficiency, we are going to get going in just a moment. You'll have seen the clock counting down, and the clock is my master. So we will make a start. I'll just allow a second or two for people to find their seats. Thank you all for getting back here fairly promptly after your lunches. I say fairly because people are still coming in. So if you would, ladies and gentlemen, as you come in, just find yourself a seat as quick as you can, because we've got a lot to get through in the next hour. As you will know, we are now addressing Arctic energy issues post the Paris Climate Change Agreement. And of course, we've touched upon this already in our discussions. I think the truth is that this is so central to discussion of the economics of the Arctic going forward that there's no way that we couldn't have already spent some time thinking about energy issues and economic exploitation issues already in this conference, but we're going to address it head on now, and we've got two panels. We're going to have a first panel and then just change the faces on the chairs and go straight ahead with a second panel. So we've got an hour of intensive discussion ahead. So what I'm going to do right now is invite my first set of panelists onto the floor, and they'll be guided gently to their seats. So I'll just read out our five names. Don't give them each an individual round of applause. It'll take too long, although they'll be very flattered. Hold your applause until we've got all five of them up on the stage. So we're going to have up on the stage... I need my glasses. I'm too old for this. I thought I could do it, but I can't. A couple of years ago, I could have, but I can't anymore. Right, so here we go. So we're having on the stage right now Bjørn Otto Sverdrup, who is Senior Vice President of Corporate Sustainability at Statoil, Jennifer Morgan, who is Executive Director of Greenpeace International, Anthony Hobley, who is CEO of the Carbon Tracker Initiative, Jan Dusik, who's Director of the Europe Office of the UN Environment Programme, and Elisabeth Turstadt, who is CEO for Oil and Gas of DNV GL. So give a very warm hand to all our panelists. Welcome, panel. So you lot don't get the privilege of 4 or 5 minutes of keynote speech. You just get me barking at you from the very beginning. So tough luck, you lot. Here is my opening thought. I hope, did you, at least some of you, maybe all of you, managed to catch the opening session with Jeffrey Sachs? And I hope you caught the powerful words from our youth representative, Ingrid. There were some important thoughts there. Jeffrey Sachs said, you know, if we're serious about meeting the Paris threshold of keeping world temperatures below the one, well, substantially below the one, the 2 degrees centigrade rise from pre-industrial levels, he said we haven't a prayer based on what we are doing right now. Things would have to change so fundamentally. And he said the message for the Arctic countries is that if you think you can practice sustainable, renewable policies at home and keep exporting fossil fuels to the rest of the world, you're kidding yourselves. You are not behaving in a responsible fashion. And Ingrid, in very simple terms, said, if you're not prepared to leave it in the ground, you're essentially screwing the planet's chances of achieving this CO2 emissions target. Both very bleak assessments in their own different ways. So here's my opening question for all of you. Do you accept that the Paris Agreement and the aims and ambitions it set, do they mean that for the Arctic nations, fossil fuel exploitation cannot happen in the way that governments and business would like? Do you accept that proposition? So let's, frankly, just to get you all in the mood, let's have each of you address that, and we'll start with you, Anthony, because you happen to be next to me.
No, absolutely, I agree with that. If we implement the INDCs under the Paris Agreement, we will reduce demand for fossil fuels by around 10% by 2030. Yet all of the major oil, gas and coal companies are projecting massive increase in demand for oil, gas and coal by 2030, somewhere between 24, 40%. I think OPEC, you know, op- optimistically projecting a growth of 50% by 2040. There's a massive disconnect. But I think what I would add to that, so Carbon Tracker, we're all former financial market professionals. The biggest, the engine room of Carbon Tracker is 8 former investment bank analysts. So we look at the numbers. That's what interests us more than anything else. Mm. And I think what I would add to that is if you try and exploit these resources, you are going to create massive stranded assets. You're going to destroy value. Because many of these projects in the Arctic, they clearly don't make climate sense. But actually, what I think we're beginning to realize is they don't make financial sense. Many of these projects will require an extremely high oil price to ever return, you know, the investment on capital, let alone make a profit. Much higher than it is today. Even with an oil price that is recovering somewhat, many of these projects, you know, will require an oil price back to the sort of halcyon days of $100 a ton. You know, the world is changing. We now have a perfect storm of factors that are eating into demand for the product from the fossil fuel companies, and they have to get their heads around the fact that the world is changing. Clean technologies, the costs of which are tumbling, the efficiencies of which are increasing, energy efficiency, a better way of doing things, and last but not least, climate policy. We call that demand destruction, and I think many analysts now, many reputable energy analysts, are now starting to talk about peak demand for coal. We're pretty much there in many respects. Oil, some people think it'll come as early as 2020. The chairman of a major global fossil fuel company in Davos last week at a session we put on felt it would come by 2030. So sometime between 2020 and 2030, peak demand. And gas. So we are facing a changing world. And let's also perhaps, you know, deal with the elephant in the room, the new president of the United States. You know, many may think that, that changes everything. But let me finish with the fact that we've seen these technological transitions before, and we are in a technology-driven low-carbon transition. Donald Trump can no more stop this technology transition than a US president could have stopped the transition from steam locomotives to the automobile, from the typewriter to the personal computer, or from fixed-line telephones to mobiles. So it's not a case of where, it's not a case of if, but it is a case of when. And I mean, that when is what is critically important as to whether we deliver a stable climate or not.
Okay, well, thanks for that, and thanks for sort of couching it in terms of the figures and the sort of business proposition. Let's mix this up a bit by getting an immediate reaction to that from Bjørn Otto Sverdrup from Statoil. Jeff Sachs said Statoil ultimately needs to change its name to Statwind. And as you are president of corporate sustainability, I should say, I'm also wondering whether that job title makes any sense, given what Jeffrey Sachs said. So, you know, you've got, frankly, in front of this audience on this topic, you've got to convince us that continued expansion of production or ambitious plans for production in the Arctic and the far north makes any kind of sense at all.
Mm. Could I first say that we're not even if we're not changing the name of Statoil, we are changing how we work and do our business related to climate. So in essence, we're changing how we run the company, embedding climate into our business strategies, changing the technical requirements and making really sure that we build a future fit Statoil. And also we're doing two more things. We're growing heavily into renewables to be part of the energy transformation. Mm-hmm. And I think Jeffrey Sachs mentioned that we just won some leases to develop offshore wind in
New York. Oh, he loves what you do in renewables. He just doesn't love what
And then also we're also looking into how do we create the right oil and gas portfolio to ensure long-term value creation.
Yeah, well, let's get to grips with that then. And what role does the Arctic play in your strategy?
No, so we believe in a knowledge-based resource management. And in order to be able to develop oil and gas resources that the world actually still need for probably some decades still, they need to meet a number of thresholds. One is that could we do it kind of in an environmentally acceptable way, managing local environmental issues? Can we do it commercially, or do we put the company at risk? Mm. Can we do it without kind of jeopardizing coexistence with other industries? And you know, the Barents or the Arctic is not one. So you have very kind of icy areas in Russia or Alaska, whereas you have more friendly environments like the southern part of the Barents Sea. So for us, some regions don't tick the boxes. We cannot do it commercially. We cannot. We don't feel that we can do it. The technology isn't ready yet to do it safely. In other areas, we believe it's okay to go ahead, and part of that is in Norway. And here we have actually been doing activities since the 1980s.
Right. I mean, you're VP of Corporate Sustainability. To what extent is it sustainable for Statoil to continue to search for and exploit oil reserves in the Barents area or wherever it is, when Jeffrey Sachs makes two powerful points? One, you'll never be able to compete just on raw price, cost of extraction with Saudi Arabia or Iran. You just will never be able to do that. It's just a totally different cost environment. So that needs bearing in mind. And then when Anthony says, you know, look at the graphs, look at where peak oil is going to sit, look at how much oil the world will need in 20, 30 years, why on earth can you not leave this black stuff in the ground?
Yeah. So I think that's an important issue. And we spend quite a lot of time inside Statoil to reflect around that. So what will the future look like? Will there be a demand for oil and gas 10, 15, 20 years from now? How do we respond to that as a company? And in essence, I think the takeout is that we would like to be part of the energy transformation, but also on oil and gas, make sure that it's low cost and low carbon. And we believe that developing resources in the Arctic, and at least in parts of Arctic, can still fit into that kind of square box.
But why? Why? I mean, why aren't you addressing this fundamental point that the world probably doesn't need it, and certainly if the world does need continued expansion of oil supply, it's not the best place to do it.
No. Okay, so why do we need to do that? It's
I mean, I can see why from a company's point of view.
No, wait. This is not company perspective, but you know, if you look on the system side, the world is running 80% on fossil fuels. And in order to replace that, we need a lot of renewables. We need a lot of kind of energy efficiencies, changes of behavior from consumers and what have you. But we cannot change that system overnight. So it's going to be a gradual shift. And in the meantime, you will still need a lot of oil and gas to be able to do that. And since existing fields are depleting, so meaning that the production is being reduced by 6-7% each year, we have to refill those resources in order to meet the energy needs that's out there.
Okay. Well, that's your case. I mean, it sounds a bit like the treatment for a drug addict being, well, we'll give him more drugs, but we'll sort of, you know, try and give him a bit less than we gave him last week. But you're not tackling the addiction. But
no,
anyway.
But I think actually, but it's not our problem alone. So because what we really need to do is to change how we use energy.
Well, that's an important part of this debate. So let me bring in, if I may, Elisabeth Torstadt, who works for another company in the sector. But I'll be honest with you, Elisabeth, I don't quite know what DNV does, but explain to me what you do and then what your sort of business perspective is on this whole argument about post-Paris energy strategy in the Arctic.
So DNVGL is all about ensuring safe and sustainable operations of the industries we work in. We support companies like Statoil and other oil companies in driving their performance as safely and sustainable as possible. So we're an independent advisor and trust provider to the industries. I share the perspective that with the overall energy poverty that we actually have in the world, we still need to produce oil and gas in order to create energy. And we need that for a long time going forward. And even if we are at peak demand, we need to replace some of that production. And then, of course, all the oil companies will fight around who replaces that production. And they have different sort of business perspectives on that.
And it's your belief, because this is all in the context of the Paris Agreement and the new target set, it's your belief that renewal of reserves, or exploration of new reserves, including in the Arctic, is entirely compatible with the overarching aim of restricting temperature rise below, significantly below 2 degrees centigrade.
renewal of reserves to some extent is compatible with those targets. But I firmly believe, as Anna Solberg said today, that we need a price on CO2 to make sure that we develop the right reserves and the right resources. I also firmly believe that we need to separate, when we talk about fossil fuels, we need to separate between oil and gas. There's different cases for oil and gas. For example, and there are different parts of the energy system that we cannot replace with renewable energy, at least not in the near term. For example, what is today used for transportation and large-scale transportation, we need to replace oil with gas, but we cannot move totally away from fossil fuels. So we can talk about electricity supply and move that to renewable energy, but we cannot replace all the elements that oil and gas is used for in the world today.
Right. Let's change sort of perspective a little bit. And I, Jennifer Morgan from Greenpeace, I don't think anybody in this audience is going to sort of believe that you're going to make a case for expanding fossil fuel production in the Arctic. So we'll take that as a given. But I want you to engage as constructively as you can with Statoil and with Elizabeth there, you know, whose businesses rely upon, to a certain extent, not entirely, but rely upon fossil fuel production in the north and including in the far north. What's Greenpeace sort of offering that isn't just condemnation and waving your arms around, but is constructive?
Well, we do a lot of constructive
things. No, I'm sure you do.
You're right. We don't think there's any room for new oil in the Arctic. Not only for the 2 degrees target, but for the 1.5 targets, and actually the phase out of greenhouse gas emissions that's in the Paris Agreement. And we've joined forces with Youth in Nature and a whole range of other organizations here, actually not just on the private sector, but we've taken the Norwegian government to court because we think that their issuing of these licenses is going up against the Constitution, which protects the environment and health of current and future generations. But at the same time, you know, we're not calling for the phase out of fossil fuel, of shutting down everything that exists now. And the thing I think that we need to look at is, this thought that more efficiency and carbon price is actually gonna be the answer to this, I just think is not listening and understanding the carbon budget and where we need to go. And we do have an opportunity to have an orderly transition, which is what we need. And Greenpeace is ready to work, and we're actually, you know, if we don't do this, it's gonna be the workers in this sector who lose. If we look now out and say, okay, this is how much time we have, we're not gonna go for new oil because we know there's no space for that. But we are gonna step by step look at how we replace existing with renewables, with efficiency, and create new jobs and have a just transition for those workers, I think that that's the way to go, and that's the way we have to go. And so engaging with that and looking at what are the new business opportunities, you know, this is happening in other parts of the world. It's, China, gosh, last week I was in Davos too. The speech by Xi Jinping was very amazing. You're hearing Greenpeace say that because he committed to the Paris Agreement very strongly. And it's clear that in their economic future, it's renewables, it's efficiency. And there were even meetings where Chinese CEOs were pushing back on oil-producing nations saying, wait a minute, we're going clean energy, you're out of step. Mm. So we're ready to work on that. But the new oil in the Arctic is just it's just not in line with where we need to go.
No, that you laid that out very clearly. Just on that, I didn't mean to be disparaging and snotty when I said waving your arms. I mean, you're a very effective campaigning organization. Mm-hmm. So just on the specific point about your approach to efforts to expand exploration and production in the far north in the Arctic, will Greenpeace take a very confrontational approach? Will you have your people out there, you know, trying to stop production assets doing their work or exploration assets, you know, because you're very good at that, and it creates a lot of media attention and it puts a huge focus on the issues. Is that Greenpeace's strategy going forward?
I think Greenpeace is going to do a range of things. I think if we engage with the government, with Statoil, with others, and there's no answer, and we have this court case moving forward, and we work with labor, and we try and create those new visions, and that doesn't work, then yes, we need, you know, this is an unbelievably important part of the world for all the reasons that you've talked about. So our supporters care about this, and they'll be there with us on that. Yeah.
Okay. So that's something you guys will have to factor in. But before you tell me how you may be going to respond to that, let's bring in our final speaker, Jan. You speak from a sort of UN perspective. I wonder what you bring to this debate about energy and the Arctic.
Right. Well, I was also listening to the Chinese president's speech the day later in Geneva when he was really filling the space for multilateralism and China's commitment for future generations. It was really inspiring. I just before this panel discussion, I received a message from a colleague that Saudi Arabia is moving to be the exporter of solar electricity as of 2023. So 6 years down the road, and I think these are the messages that the train has left the station, is moving on. And one thing is the multilateral basis, which is the Paris Agreement, complemented in Marrakesh, complemented by other things like the Kigali Amendment of the Montreal Protocol that brings the ozone question and the climate question together and makes additional 0.5 degrees Celsius reduction. So these are all multilateral elements, and of course they need to be complemented by action, and that action is already happening. And one thing that Jeffrey Sachs mentioned this morning is that the science tells us that we have to do it for the 2 degrees and rather 1.5 degrees. And the other is that the science also tells us that we can do it, and it's perfectly feasible, and we need to go on that pathway. And that's where we also come from the United Nations perspective, following the trends, following the leaders in the private sector, which are already moving in that direction. And if I look at the Arctic countries, they can also fill the space that is being vacated by others, and they can lead by example and show that the technology is there, it is economically feasible, it is environmentally or climate imperative, and that's why it should move forward as quickly as
it can. Do you think you know, it's useful or relevant to talk about the Arctic countries when it comes to future energy exploration? Because obviously different countries have different attitudes, and we've talked a lot about cooperation and multilateralism, but the truth is, you know, Russia's view of its energy strategy going forward is probably very different from Norway's and very different again from Canada's. So is there truly, you know, despite all the nice stuff that happens around Arctic councils and Arctic frontier conferences, is there anything meaningfully cooperative and joint about the Arctic nations' approach to future energy strategy?
I think I would say two things. One is that you cannot see the Arctic in isolation from the rest of the world, and a number of speakers this morning said that the problem is global, the solutions need to be applied globally as well. Secondly, if you look across the Arctic countries, you can see that the United States and Canada have prohibited drilling in the Arctic, of course under different conditions these days, but still this could be an inspiration for a joint Arctic countries' action and a responsible approach, which will also...
In all honesty, do you think that would inspire Moscow?
Well, the Arctic cooperation is one of the best governance regimes that exist in the world, so I believe that a number of good things have been achieved, and this could also be something that could be brought on the table, and the universal problem of climate change can be tackled by the Arctic countries.
Mm. Goodness, that was incredibly diplomatic, all of that. No wonder you're at the UN. all right, I did, as usual, I should have said and I forgot, but I want to promise you that SMS messages, questions to that number will definitely get an airing. So we've got one here for the panel. This might be one for you. Carbon pricing is necessary for low carbon transmission. How do you consider the linkages between different pricing mechanisms?
It's always a difficult one for me to answer because I spent nearly 20 years of my career trying to build carbon markets, the European carbon market, the Australian carbon market, and implementing them, both from a policy, writing the law side of things, and actually doing carbon projects around the world. I mean, it is clear that a carbon price is the most efficient and effective way. And if we can get a meaningful carbon price, it will drive transition, entrepreneurial energy, like
it has to be global.
Else. it has to be global. And that's where we come to the nub. You know, all of us who've given a lot of our years to building carbon prices have learned the hard way the political difficulties of getting a carbon price. If we get one, fantastic. But the good news, and in it, you know, in much of Carbon Tracker's financial analysis, much of our demand analysis, we are actually quite pessimistic about whether we will get a meaningful carbon price. And actually, it doesn't seem to matter at the moment, because the clean technologies, the costs of those are coming down so dramatically, they are already competing in many places around the world with fossil fuels, without a carbon price, without subsidies. They are already giving fossil fuels a run for their money, and in many places are now the cheaper option. It's just that many, you know, like that cartoon character that runs off the edge of the cliff, it's taking them a little while to catch up with that new reality. Now, clearly, any climate policy, carbon pricing, will drive that even faster and will be a good thing, because we have to do this as quickly as possible. So we should not let up on the efforts to get that. But the costs of the technologies are coming down so dramatically that even without a carbon price, there is huge investment risk if you put your money into fossil fuel projects, particularly those in the Arctic. And I think we've got to get that message across. There is a real financial risk. Carbon pricing will increase that financial risk, but it is there already, which is why the Financial Stability Board's new report on disclosing climate risk is so important that investors begin to understand this. So coming to your previous question, money makes the world go round. If you don't pay attention as investors and shareholders of these companies, and you let the companies continue to pour trillions into these high-cost projects that make neither climate nor financial sense, you're going to lose money. You're going to destroy value. And why is that important to all of us in the room? Because we all have pensions and investments. So the people who manage those, if they don't wake up to this, they're going to destroy the value of your pensions and your retirement. That's why you have to also start to pay attention to this.
Interesting. Can the screen go back to the other question we had? Because it was quite relevant and a good one. Can we bring that question back, the question that was sitting on the screen a minute ago? That's a challenge for everybody, and the screen seems to be saying no. But where can you bring back the last? Because I want to make sure people's questions do get aired. We've had that one. There was another one that came up, and then you took it away. The next question. No, that wasn't it either.
That one.
Yeah, that's the one. Because it's relevant to what Anthony's just said, and I would like perhaps you two, maybe Statoil can start. But the question is this, and it'll have to be the last one, unfortunately. By supplying more non-renewable energy, do you not think you are part of discouraging renewable energy developments?
I think the short answer is no. And the reason for that is that renewables are mainly in the electricity sphere. And oil is not used for producing electricity. And a very little share of natural gas is used to produce electricity. It mainly goes into petrochemicals, heating, or others. And actually, hadn't it been for natural gas, for instance, I think you would have seen difficulty having the growth in renewables, because you need to have ways of handling the intermittencies when the sun isn't shining and the wind isn't blowing. So I think the short answer is no. To that
Elizabeth,
one.
You
but could I just have one question, and it goes to your point.
Yeah, go on.
Because I think all of us share the same view around climate. You know, we need to change the energy systems, and we need to limit emissions.
And ultimately to decarbonize.
Yeah.
And
yeah,
Statoil has to accept that.
Yeah, and
decarbonize.
Yeah, and decarbonize and phase out emissions. That's fine. I struggle a bit with when you ask what's the role of the Arctic in this, because. What is actually the climate benefit of not developing resources in the Arctic if it's being developed elsewhere? Because this is a global issue.
Let's hear the answer, because then we've got to wrap. So I just want to hear Jennifer's answer, then I'm afraid we have to wrap.
There's two reasons. One is a science reason, which, you know, you do get more emissions when you develop oil in the Arctic. But the second is that we have so little time, and if Norway does not start, this wealthy nation that can take care of its people and have a just transition to not drill in the Arctic, how can we be engaging any developing countries in this space? That's why. And there are countries that are moving in this direction. And Norway, I feel like, I work with Norway in the climate negotiations. It's a good global citizen. But this drilling in the Arctic is undercutting that. And I think it sets a terrible example for developing countries that want to have a different pathway. So that's why it matters.
The screen says time's up, so I'll give you 10 seconds to respond. It's a fascinating debate, and I'm sure it'll continue.
You know, but it's a very important debate.
About leadership as much as anything.
We try to lead this way. And we are also concerned about which hydrocarbons you produce. And I would much rather produce gas out of Norway in the EU climate system where you get overall reductions down than producing coal in China.
Well, China closed 100 coal-fired power plants last week, folks. Yeah. So.
Okay. But be real.
Great discussion. Great discussion. If I were on Hard Talk, I'd want it to continue, but unfortunately, the screen says, and the screen's right, we've got to stop because we've got another panel to get to before 2:30. So can I just ask everybody to give this panel a very, very warm hand. Thank you very much. Thank you all. Okay, don't move, ladies and gentlemen, because we've got another panel coming straight up. So I'm going to do the same thing as before. I'm just going to tell you, everybody who's on the panel, as I come out with the names, panelists, if you please take a seat, and then we'll give you a round of applause when you're all here. So could I invite Connie Hedegaard, who is now public investigator for the Norwegian government's project on green competitiveness, Richard Glenn, Executive VP of the Arctic Slope Regional Corporation, Pam Pearson, Director of the International Cryosphere Climate Initiative. Elizabeth is staying on the panel, I'm delighted to say, as is Bjørn Otto Sverdrup from Statoil. Thank you two for staying. And thank you three for joining. And let's give the new three newcomers a round of applause. Thank you. So we've got our two representatives of the oil business still with us, and now we've surrounded you with another different set of perspectives. Actually, Connie, I'll start with you. I mean, I've known you for years because we used to talk and joust with each other when you were Denmark's environment minister, and your record goes back a long, long way to Copenhagen Climate Summit, and obviously you've been involved in these issues for an awful long time as an environment minister and now working with Norway on these issues. And interestingly, your position... You need to, I suppose, tell us how you respond to what you've heard from Statoil today, given your position now looking at green competitiveness for Norway.
Actually, we delivered our report in late October. And part of that report was to have 12 different sectors come up with their roadmap. Not to ask, should we go low carbon, but how to do it. And there were a lot of good roadmaps done, also one from the petroleum industry. But I have to say that it was not I recognize fully how difficult it is for that sector, but it's also clear that it was not the most ambitious roadmap. And at some point in our two-person committee there, before we delivered the report to the Prime Minister, I said we cannot have that the oil and gas industry would be the only sector in Norway who could basically continue business as usual.
Right.
But then we came up with sort of one recommendation to the government on the oil and gas sector. And as a Dane, I must say, I was sort of struck by how aggressive that seemed in a Norwegian context, because what we actually said was that we recommended to the government that they should consider the need for changes in the current petroleum regime. This is to avoid that Norway avoids taking higher risks in a market with increasing uncertainty of demand. And we said we should prepare a sensitivity analysis in Norway before taking the decision whether there should be new explorations. Mm. I thought that was sort of a rather sort of modest recommendation, but it's interesting in the Norwegian debate to see, wow, that is just something, because today...
Hang on, what do you mean? You mean you've got an awful lot of resistance to that?
Yes, because it's not really the big discussion in Norway. And the reality is, and that was what we were targeting, that is, today the Norwegian society gets 78% of the revenues gained from extraction. Mm. But it also means that the Norwegian society and the taxpayers are taking 78% of the risk of doing new investments. And that is basically what we recommended to the government. We cannot imagine the same regime that served Norway so well for the last 40 years, building up this whole stronghold in their economy, that could not be unchanged when we are moving towards a low carbon society. And I think that should be a no-brainer to start discuss. How should that regime change? Of course not overnight, but gradually.
Why did you kick back against Connie's report so fiercely?
We haven't kicked back.
No, they were totally silent.
I mean, we are probably actually one of the biggest taxpayers in the world, Statoil. And also Jeffrey Sachs talked about the importance of equality. So we are paying nearly 78% tax, and we haven't really started a discussion, but I guess that if somebody is saying, hey, we're going to reduce the tax rate, I guess we will actually welcome that.
Well, yeah, but I didn't really think Connie's point was really about reducing tax rates. It was about you looking to the future and accepting that to pursue fossil fuel exploration and production in the way you have in the past, in the future, would not just be damaging to the global environment, would probably also be very risky and damaging to your business, because the whole environment has changed and it won't make you money in the future as it's made you in the past.
Yeah. So now this is so how do we manage that risk? And I think it's a very profound question. And you know, this the G20 Bloomberg Commission is looking into really this. Is there a financial risk, a systemic risk related to climate change? So what they're asking for is companies to report and disclose to what extent are you exposed to this climate risk. And as one of the first companies in the world, we have made that kind of assessment, and we've done that openly, reported about it. And it showed that, at least with our existing portfolio, we showed that if we enter a kind of low carbon world, 450 scenario until 2040, the value at risk in Statoil is less than 5%. So we are actually assessing this risk very thoroughly. Mm-hmm. It's part of our, you know, really embedding that kind of climate risk into how we operate the business.
All right. Well, we must.
So we don't see that risk of stranded assets in that time perspective.
Right. That's a phrase that seems quite relevant. Stranded assets. That by that you mean that you pour money into exploration in the Arctic, and that for reasons to do with the global economy and carbon pricing and everything else, production becomes absolutely economically impossible from those places. So you leave all the oil in the ground. You've committed a lot of money to an investment which proves to be useless.
Yeah, but that's not something new and not something unique really related to climate issues, because you have that nearly all the time. Even if you drill a well that's too... The reservoir is
sure,
too,
yeah, with the fluctuating oil
below
price,
economic thresholds, yeah. There are political reasons, sanctions coming in,
sure.
Environmental issues, what have you.
I get you. Okay, I don't want this to be just about Norway and Norway's Arctic explorations, because, you know, here we are at Arctic frontiers thinking about all of the Arctic nations and areas. So let's talk a little bit about the Arctic slope. And I say that because, Richard, you're the executive vice president of the Arctic Slope Regional Corporation. All the same sort of factors about the economics of fossil fuel exploration and production and the climate change agenda and the post-Paris pressures, right. They all apply to you too.
Right. And the reality is, though, that all of our Arctic communities in Alaska are dependent upon continued hydrocarbons. Much the same way the icebreakers from the Norwegian Research Institute are powered by bunker fuel. If you go to any small Arctic community in Alaska today, you're going to see the bulk fuel tank farm. It's filled with diesel fuel in general to power the generators and heat the homes. And so the irony of flying here in a jet plane and staying at a hotel and then telling my communities that they should be without hydrocarbons for their own
survival. Well, I don't think anybody's saying that necessarily, but they're just saying that...
I kind of get the feeling of it.
But it's more about future production than it is about your community's reliance upon fossil fuels to heat their homes.
So the continuing reality is that the The oil industry of today is not my father's industry, especially not my grandfather's industry. Think that has changed with time also. And renewables have grown into a role. And cleaner energy, more efficient housing design, everything else is working to reduce the carbon footprint of even our most rural communities. It displaces some of this hydrocarbon, but it doesn't replace it entirely. And when it doesn't replace it entirely, you still are tied to the whole hydrocarbon infrastructure to keep the communities going. So,
but are you saying these communities, not just they still rely on fossil fuel for their for their living, but these communities also are totally full-on committed to further exploration and production in your region?
So I say that the viability of a given project should transcend Arctic and non-Arctic boundaries, and it's becomes issue depending on that prolificness, that size, that economics, so to somehow pencil out the Arctic from continued debate of hydrocarbon versus non-hydrocarbon, because in addition to our communities depending on this in such a simple way, and we're doubly conflicted in my region because the economy of our region is oil and gas development. And
are you very, I mean, you know, never mind how you voted, but are you just very pleased with the different tone and message you're getting from the Trump team from the message you got from Obama?
I don't think we know what the message is from the Trump
team. Well, that's a fair point. insofar as one can read the tweets and the different sort of...
This industry has been present in our part of the world, and I helped our town move from a diesel-based appetite to a locally produced natural gas appetite. So think of all the diesel we helped displace in one town for the last 50 years. So I know that resource development in the Arctic can be done safely in a way that pays the bills and in a way that doesn't jeopardize, or this issue of old oil and new oil, new fields in the Arctic unfairly oversimplifies the debate.
Okay, all right. Well, thanks for that perspective. We heard earlier from Jennifer from Greenpeace with an international perspective. Pam, I'm going to confess, I don't know so much about the International Cryosphere Climate Initiative.
No, it doesn't surprise me that you don't. We're in some ways, we're sort of a mirror to Greenpeace because we are a very small organization that works with governments. We consist of a largely volunteer force of diplomats, a lot of ex-climate ambassadors from Sweden, from Norway, from India, and cryosphere scientists, a lot of IPCC lead authors, former vice chair of the IPCC. And what unifies us is our alarm, frankly, at the lack of understanding in the policy world as to how close we are coming to crossing some of the thresholds that Jeffrey Sachs talked about. And I need to say before I say this, I totally understand the pain that this might cause in places like Alaska. Ironically, even though I'm an ex-diplomat that's focused on, you know, cryosphere issues right now, cryosphere is snow and ice regions. Chose the name intentionally because this needs to become a leading factor in the climate debate. But I'm a native Texan. I grew up surrounded by the oil industry. I was born in Dallas. I went to school in Houston. A lot of the people I went to school with work in the oil industry. My first posting overseas was Ecuador. My last posting was here in Norway, where I worked with the oil industry. Nevertheless, as the vice chair of the IPCC said in Paris, where we held a side event, you can't negotiate the freezing point of water. And the problem is, and I'm going to sort of sharpen this and get specific, because there are Arctic and cryosphere pillars of the climate system that we just can't debate about. And if you lose these, we're going to lose the climate. And we're very close to that right now. We've got sort of five pillars that we focus on. Two are semi-reversible, Arctic summer sea ice and mountain glaciers, okay? Based on what's been emitted so far, we have lost the mountain glaciers in the tropical regions and in the mid-latitudes. There will be no more glaciers left here in Ferro-Scandinavia. There will be none left in the continental United States. There will not be in the central Andes, just based on how much has been emitted so far. So we're committed to that. Three, irreversible though, and these are where it gets dangerous. We've got permafrost, which is beginning to thaw. We've got ice sheets, and some of these are going to be triggered at 1.5 or 1.6 degrees. We are committed to 1.5, 1.6 degrees already right now. And also, I put into that polar ocean acidification, and the reason that's so important, all of these are driven not by sort of where we get by 2100, but what the peak temperature is or what the peak CO2 levels are. Ocean acidification, once the ocean draws in that acidity, it takes 50 to 70,000 years for the ocean to buffer out again. This is an irreversible kind of change. In real time, the ocean has had the same pH for about 35 million years right now. So this is a huge change in the ocean ecosystem that is driven entirely by CO2 levels. And if people can take away two things, is that they are irreversible thresholds. They're changes that are not going to go away. They can't be restored, the ice sheets in particular, without, in essence, a new ice age. And you get the West Antarctic ice sheet involved right about now. That's 6 to 8 meters of committed sea level rise. It will take a long time to occur. But once it starts, we can't stop it. There literally is no way to stop it. Greenland, if we're at 1.6 degrees for more than a couple, three centuries, the altitude goes down, it starts melting irreversibly. And so at this point, though, Paris, if you look at peak temperatures, Paris commitments get us to 4 degrees. It's going to be 2300.
When you throw all of these alarming facts at me, which are truly alarming and depressing, and you sink further and further into your chair as you hear them, then I think, you know, about the point earlier, the fact is, you know, oil and gas isn't used for power, for electricity. It's used in the automotive industry still. It's used in aviation still. What are you suggesting, that we just shut down whole sectors of our economy that still rely on oil and gas? I mean, there is still going to be a demand for oil and gas, despite the alarming facts that you present about what's happening to the cryosphere. I don't know what we do. What do we do?
Well, and I think that's it, because we need to first accept the fact that this is what's happening. And when you look at it as a climate emergency, I think there's that paradigm shift that Jeffrey Sachs talked about, where we need to move more quickly, and we can move more quickly. There's so many things we can do, and one of the nice...
We haven't got much time. So how disappointed are you by the sorts of things that that we've heard today from Bjørn, Otto, and from Elizabeth, who, you know, represent businesses and stakeholders who... you know, have made a very legitimate living out of fossil fuels? What do you say to them today?
Well, what I'm hearing them saying is that if they get the proper signals from government, that they are thinking about their companies less as oil and gas companies and more as energy companies. And that's the kind of paradigm shift that really
needs to
take
place. But you're just telling them they've got to get much more of a move on. They've got to shift much quicker.
Yeah, yeah.
Elizabeth, are you... Sorry, Connie, but...
Well, first of all, we are a company that's spread across industries, so we have equally strong presence in the renewable energy industry as we have in oil and gas. So we have made that move, and we are moving in that direction. And our prime concern in the oil and gas industry, again, is to make sure that we're in that industry as safely and as sustainable as possible, including driving the energy efficiency. And I think that exactly...
Do you get it, that sense of alarm that we've just heard from Pam? You totally buy it. You're as alarmed as me.
I am alarmed, and we are supporting the industry today in acting in two ways. There are two ways that I think we should do more. One is to look more at energy systems. I firmly believe that natural gas and renewable energy in particular can create systems that are much more energy efficient per se than when we look at the two in isolation. So that's the first thing that needs to happen to a larger scale, not sort of continue a confrontational line, but to look at those systems and optimize those systems in terms of energy efficiency and cost and emissions. And that also includes driving, using more renewable energy into oil and gas extraction and production, because there's huge opportunities in the value chain of oil and gas to reduce emissions. Today at Norwegian Continental Shelf, we know, we heard today as well, that this is one of the most emission effective production sites in the world. Still, 29% of emissions on Norwegian Continental Shelf today can be cut in a cost-efficient manner. And this is something the industry
needs to happen quick.
it needs to happen quick, but this is an opportunity and not really a threat to the industry.
Okay. Connor, you would...
An opportunity, but also there are a lot of good things happening. Mm-hmm. I mean, see the development in cars, in transportation, just to take one example. See what has happened with renewables and the cost of renewables, things like that. And I just think that if it's about sort of this Arctic village not being... not having its diesel consumption today. That's not what we're talking about. We are talking about long-term politics. And of course, the companies means a lot, but they are, of course, taking care of their business. So what we really need is also a long-term policy thinking. Mm-hmm. And that is what is required, because then we can do it. Yes, we do not have a lot of time, but we can do it with a gradual development. Whereas if we're just leaning back and continuing business as usual, then we will have a total disruption in our lifestyle. I still belong to those who think it is possible, provided that the politicians across the political spectrum really start to get...
Sure, but I mean, you know, it's kind of easier to say that now you're a consultant. When you were a politician...
No, I say what we, for instance, did when I was an EU commissioner, setting up the 2030 targets, very specific targets, implementing very specific... standards, regulations, technology specifications, things like that, and then work with business. This is not only politics or only business. It's sort of whole society coming together. And it's just before we sort of end up just being alarmed. Mm-hmm. I also see some evidence that we are actually starting to see this new real possibilities being out there instead of just gloom and doom. Yeah. It's also about opportunities, as you write.
Okay. Well, I know you wanted to say something, Bjørn Otto, but I do want to make sure we get the SMS questions in. This is, you know, and it's good to mix up the big picture stuff we're talking about with some specifics. So here's something specific. I don't know who would want to answer it, but can carbon capture solutions give the oil and gas industry a future in this carbon-constrained world we're talking about? I mean, it's a perennial question whether carbon capture... Mm-hmm. And storage is going to save the fossil fuel industry by giving us a solution to the emissions, is it?
Can I answer that? Well, at least try. I think the answer should be, or the question should be the other way around, but I firmly believe that carbon capture and storage is necessary, because I do see the need for gas in particular as part of the energy solution for a long time going forward, and I think carbon capture and storage is necessary to
right, but
to do
I mean,
that.
People have been working on it for ages and ages, and we still don't seem to be really getting close to a viable, big-scale solution.
Could I just chip in there?
Yes.
Because isn't it funny that hundreds of kilometers north of here, we are running one of the world's larger kind of carbon capture and storage facilities.
A proper commercial CCS operation.
Yeah. So, and, you know, that's... At least we have proven that that technology it works. You can deposit CO2 permanently in geological layers. But as you said, it's not commercially viable yet. Mm. And probably over the long term, in order to reach negative emissions, you would need to develop carbon capture technology. Mm-hmm. I'd just like to say to you, Pam, I think we are way beyond recognizing that the climate, the global warming is going on. We're way beyond that. So now it's about how do we effectively address it. And I think there is striking that we talk so little about how we as consumers, individuals, need to use much less energy. You know, travel less and buildings need to be constructed differently. So you need to attack the demand side as well, not only the supply side. And personally, I think on the supply side, we also need to look at which hydrocarbons is it really that we would like to get rid of. And of course, coal is so fundamental to the world's energy mix. It holds twice the carbon intensity and a lot of other local issues. So I guess when Beijing is moving forward on the climate policy, it's primarily driven out of local pollution issues. Mm-hmm. And I think we should play to that sentiment. And, you know, it's ridiculous, isn't it, that in Europe, coal is still growing in parts, in many countries. And I think it's a shame.
Mm.
So we should be more realistic and, you know, specific when we discuss important climate issues.
Yeah, hold your thought, Pam, because I just, again, just want to make sure that we get... this concept of negative emissions, I'm not entirely sure I entirely understand it, but I bet you lot do. So what is the role of negative emissions as a concept in the energy future?
Yeah. And I can sort of take that. I mean, negative emissions are basically carbon recovery.
Right.
In other words, and what a lot of people are not aware of is the modeling that talks about getting us to 1.5 or 1.6 degrees assumes that the world's energy solutions are negative emissions starting already in 2070. That's the only way to get there. So it can be anything from planting trees to fixing things via agriculture. I do want to say a bit of a word of caution on natural gas. You know, bridge in bridge, it's still, even in a best case scenario, 50%. Of the emissions of coal, and that doesn't talk about, you know, methane leakage and so on. So that's why we want to be careful using bridge, you know, fuels, not to go too far and again damage some of the recyclables, which was one of the renewables, which is one of the questions that came in the previous session.
That's right. Yeah. Okay. Well, another question: is carbon pricing a fig leaf for business as usual when it comes to oil and gas companies? I.e., it's a distraction rather than a solution. Who'd like to take that on? Connie, yeah?
I think carbon pricing is essential. And I think that pricing in general, to price externalities, that is the big next thing we all need to understand, whether it's on climate or on environment or whatever, scarce resources, to get the pricing right. That is what we really need. Now we have Paris and we have the SDGs and we have a lot of things. We still have a lot of finance ministries who haven't understood the profound message yet. And that's why we are not pricing activities in the right manner. The day we really start to do that, then we will see change much faster.
First, it's a 4 billion NOK fig leaf. Because that's what we pay in carbon taxes.
Right.
And the reality is that those carbon taxes shifts behavior inside companies. Because you search for more energy efficient solutions. So I think I couldn't agree more than with Connie. It's really, really important. And you know, the changes that we have to do to change the infrastructure of societies, there's not a country that can subsidize that. You need to play with the market sentiment to get the investors and shift investment strategies.
We're nearly out of time. I just want to end, you know, because this is all happening in the context of the big picture that Jeffrey Sachs laid out, that the Paris Climate Change Treaty lays out, that you, Pam, have referred to. So just quick thought from the end, at the end, from all of you. Do you believe that what we are going to see over the next 20 years in terms of energy policy in the Arctic, amongst the Arctic nations, is going to help or hinder humanity's efforts to meet those targets of keeping, you know, temperature rise below 2 and hopefully closer to 1.5 degrees centigrade? Is the Arctic going to be a major negative factor, or could it be a positive?
I think the rising tide floats all boats. The changes in technology that happen worldwide will have their effect proportionately in the Arctic. So, but to magnify the Arctic's response to this global issue is not fair.
You're saying don't make a special case of the Arctic. Okay, Pam.
I say make a special case of the Arctic because I think, and I am an optimist in this way, because I really think that because in this region you see the impacts of climate change so very clearly, that will motivate the governments, including eventually the U.S. and Russia, to make the changes that are necessary. Yeah.
10 years ago, there were a lot of plans to develop oil and gas in the Arctic, in Greenland, East and West, Russia, Alaska, Northern Canada.
Yeah.
Those plans have gone.
What percentage of those plans are left?
I don't have the number
roughly,
there.
But, you know, 20%?
U.S. sanctions have removed Russia, right? Because you...
Right.
And then... it's not economically viable. So I think there will be much less resources developed in the Arctic now than what you believed only 10 years ago. But still, I think it's there will be some resources that can play an important role.
Mm. Elizabeth?
I think both energy and CO2 are part of global systems, and you cannot isolate the Arctic. I think there is special effects in the Arctic, in particularly the fact that we see climate change so clearly. But apart from that, we need to look at the global systems, and we can't isolate the Arctic.
Sure. I think that with the low oil prices, it's not as profitable to extract in the Arctic area. So it's a perfect timing to rethink so that the social development that we need in the Arctic area for the future should definitely not be built on more fossil fuels extraction.
What a wonderfully disciplined panel you are. You've ended bang on time. I thank you for that, and more particularly, I thank you for a fascinating discussion and for the previous one too. So thank you very much indeed. Ladies and gentlemen, you'll be happy to know, quick tea and coffee break, and then back here, the Arctic Environment Forum begins at 3 p.m. sharp, so be back for that. Thank you very much indeed, and panel, thank you very much.